Blackstone Publishing presents Trouble at Temescal, a Western duo by Frank Bonham, edited by Bill Pronzini. This book is read by Armando Durán. Foreword by Bill Pronzini. During the 1940s, Frank Bonham wrote scores of novelettes and short stories for such Western and adventure pulp magazines as Dime Western, Ace High Western, Lariat, Blue Book, and Action Stories. His output of short fiction substantially declined in the early 1950s as the pulp markets dwindled and his focus shifted to longer works. Trouble at Temescal, Argosy, 1151, was one of only six stories to appear under his byline in 1951, and his last piece of magazine fiction was published the following year. From then on, he devoted himself exclusively to Western, mystery, and young adult novels. Set in the Pueblo of Los Angeles and the days following the Mexican-American War, Trouble at Temescal tells the tale of two entrepreneurial mustangers, Hank Ashwood and Red Wolfe, who have driven a herd of horses from New Mexico to California for resale. Their efforts to sell the animals to one of the Mexican hacendados, Dona Julia de la Torre, owner of Rancho Temescal, are hampered by a scabrous group of squatters led by Owen Pike, bent on claiming rights to her land. Racially biased ownership laws, the actions of a hot-tempered neighbor, Ramon Calder, Ashwood's growing love for Julia, and his partner's unexpected duplicity provide additional complications. As with all of Bonham's Western and historical fiction, the historical period and background are accurately and colorfully depicted, and there is excitement aplenty throughout. A total of 17 Western novels appeared under the Bonham byline between 1948 and 1980, outstanding among them such titles as Snake Track, Blood on the Land, Night Raid, Hard Rock, and Logan's Choice. His last novel, Eye of the Hunter, was published posthumously in 1989. Action, suspense, deftly developed characters, and a fine sense of time and place are the hallmarks of each of these works. King of the Defiances is the restored version of an original paperback novel by Frank Bonham, first published in 1956, and appearing in this form for the first time. It is the story of Big Jim Jackson, former boss of the range in the Defiance Mountains, who was driven out after his 20-year government lease expired, and who intends to return to make a new fortune by logging off the best railroad tie timber in Arizona, and of former manhunter Troy Cameron, the leader of a group of small cattle ranchers who stand in Jackson's way. Through devious means, Jackson now holds notes on the rancher's land and plans to foreclose if the notes aren't met on time. And he has a hired crew of gun hands ready to use force against anyone who resists. With all of this power behind him, Jackson is confident he'll have little trouble once again crowning himself King Defiance. But he doesn't reckon on the determination of Cameron, a man whose fighting spirit makes him a fearsome adversary. Trouble at Temescal. 1. Beyond the meadow, he could see a vineyard. And beyond the vineyard, the huge adobe building with sheds and outer houses, huddled like hawk-frightened chicks around a hen. The lacy round heads of pepper trees made shade everywhere.
"What they call a hacienda, I reckon," Hank Ashwood said.
He whittled shavings for a fire, his big horseman's hands easy and familiar with the green river knife stroking off the long, even curls of wood. From the gully beside their horse camp, Red Wolf came swinging into view with the dripping water bags bearing him down. He poured some water into the Dutch oven and began crumbling jerky into it.
"We sure come to the right place, Hank. There's money in this outfit. I hear these California hacendados are crazy for a blonde, whether it's a horse or a woman. I'm telling you what's the truth. We'll sell these yellow horses at 100 a head."
"I'd feel surer of it if they were blonde women," Hank Ashwood said.
Chain hobbled, the horse herd grazed tranquilly. Aside from the need for currying, they looked good. Ex-army mounts, most of them, bought cheaply in New Mexico and trailed to the Pueblo of Los Angeles for resale. Red threw a handful of dried vegetables into the kettle. He was a stretchy, middle-sized man of 25 who could never sit easy. He had to be busy all the time. Around a horse camp, it came in handy. He took a deep breath. Smoke yonder must be the town. Real hell roar, what I heard. The thin dusting of freckles spread across his face with a quick smile.
You know what I'm going to do with my cut of these here plugs?
Blow it on craps, women, and whiskey. In 2 days. After 5 months on the trail.
Hank spoke gruffly and gave the stew a stir. But he smiled a little in his whisker stubble. Red would do all right. A mite wild, maybe. But his red head was screwed on tightly enough when it counted. They had met in Santa Fe when Hank was just out of the army, and Red was on the loose from some money-making project or another that hadn't paid off. Hank had never learned just what. Some horse talk over a bottle of whiskey had made them friends. Red knew his way around, and Hank had some back pay and poker winnings burning in his pocket. So they became partners. They finished the bottle and shook hands and went out to look over the army mounts. 5 months had brought them this far along the trail, and about as close as two men can get. From his possible sack, Red had produced a steel mirror and was looking himself over. He bared his teeth and fingered a knife scar on his cheekbone.
Buddy, I'll strike a hard bargain with the señoritas hereabouts. They'll know how Red Wolf likes his bacon before I leave. How about you? What you figuring to do with your cut?
I'll find something, Hank said.
When the fire was going well, the smoke seemed to release something in both of them. They stood watching the sunset fume along the horizon until Red noticed a covey of blackbirds strutting on the cropped grass 100 feet away. Abruptly, he drew his Colt and fired into their midst. One of them exploded into feathers as the rest scurried off.
What the hell was that for? Hank said.
Red grinned devilishly at the smoking pistol as he said,
Ain't you ever felt that way? So full of vinegar you could bust? Man, what are you? A gelding or something?
Hank smiled, but he pointed out across the gullied pasture.
If the people in that castle ain't used to gringos, they'll be putting furniture in front of the doors tonight.
They ought to be used to 'em. If they ain't, they'll know about Yankees before we leave.
A few minutes later, they heard the horsemen coming across the field from the buildings. It was now late dusk, and the windows of the ranch house were orange with lamplight. There were the sounds of cows lowing to be milked, of sheep, and the family sounds of chickens going to roost. The fragrance of wood smoke and food drifted past Hank Ashwood's nose. He would always think of charcoal fumes and frying chilies when he thought of Mexicans. Red was shaving cake coffee into their cups, listening to the.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.